Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the show. It's been a while, I've been gone, but I am back with yet another episode talking about another one of those movies that you guys have requested time and time again. And here it is, Miami Connection. And boy, is this one a gem. Now let me start off by saying that Miami Connection gets my seal of approval. I would recommend all of you check this out if you have the chance, because this is a great bad movie. Miami Connection has so many elements that I look for in a bad movie, and many more that I never even knew I wanted until now. Like a story that connects drugs, ninjas, bikers, and a band somehow, and an emotional subplot that comes completely out of nowhere, yet provides an incredible monologue. The movie starts somewhere in Miami with a cocaine deal that is suddenly interrupted by a bunch of ninjas on motorcycles. Now some of you are probably thinking, Mark, this is ridiculous. I mean, you mean to tell me they're just gonna leave those perfectly good noodles behind? Yes. Yes, they are. It's shocking, I know. We're in a realm here of movies where, you know, you can't just, they're gonna waste food. They're just gonna do it. They just don't care. And you know what? There's something about that that I respect. Something about that ruthlessness. You know what? F*** those noodles. They only care about the cocaine. Noodles, sure, there's people starving. Sure, you know, you can throw those noodles in the cupboard and they're good for, you know, pretty much forever. But no, they don't care. They just want that cocaine. That's their main focus. I want noodles now. Ah, I should have ate before this. But the good news is that the following action sequence provides some pretty good moments, including a severed arm shot that rivals the one from Samurai Cop.
Man, I'm Coppa!
Anyways, the ninjas take off with the cocaine and then travel to Orlando, which is where this movie mostly takes place. So Jeff welcomes the leader of the ninja gang, Yoshido, who is his Miami connection, and they go into the club where the band Dragon Sound is playing. Jeff is pissed off because his sister is apparently friends with the band and looks to be romantically involved with the bassist, John. And I don't really see what the problem is here, Jeff. Are you concerned for your sister's well-being? Okay, well, you're a drug dealer. You want her getting involved with someone like you? It's not like she's hanging out with Motley Crue. I mean, this band is as tame as it gets. I mean, just listen to these lyrics. However, it is possible that this is all just a cover for something else. Maybe they're not really musicians at all, because just watching Mark, I'm beginning to think that he's not actually playing that guitar. The character of Mark is played by YK Kim, and YK Kim also produced this movie. He's a very experienced martial artist, which is great for the fighting portions. However, the only problem with casting him is that at least at the time of filming this movie, his English wasn't the greatest.
Ireland, we play in Israel. That's where my parents are from.
I didn't realize this before. Dragon Sound is really an international band.
So Jane and John are at school when Jeff shows up with his gang. And by the way, I gotta mention, at some point, it's a possibility. I'm gonna mix up these names. You got John, Jeff, Jane, Jack, and Jim. Like, what the f***? Anyways, Jeff shows up with just a shit ton of people for some reason. I mean, he's just going to pick up his sister from school. He didn't know John would be with her.
Where'd you find this son of a bitch?
He's a friend of mine from school.
A friend?
How can you act like that?
Shut up!
I'm just wondering, what would the appropriate response be? Like, the guy just loses his mind at the idea of this guy being her friend. A friend? A friend! I thought this was just some guy you were having sex with, but a friend? Luckily, the band steps in to break things up, but just listen to the line delivery here. It's amazing how fast it kills any intensity that was building up.
Are these bums your friends? There's just some misunderstanding.
You don't understand. I'm her brother. When I tell you to leave her alone, leave her alone.
Whatever you say.
Just remember what I said if you don't want to get hurt.
You don't scare me at all.
Jane, I want to talk to you later.
Goodbye. Let's go.
So Jeff talks with Yoshido, who's like, yeah, we got to get rid of that band so you can control that area. And I'm not exactly sure what I'm missing here. What does the band have to do with your ability to sell cocaine? They play music. You sell drugs. These are typically different businesses. I mean, sometimes, yes, musicians might contribute to the sale of drugs, but stopping it? How is that interfering with your control of the area? Dragon Sound, you know, these guys just want to go to school, they want to practice Taekwondo, you know, they want to write songs about being friends. What's the issue here? Right before their show, they go to a restaurant and eat. Nothing else happens in this scene. It's literally just a scene of them eating. And then we go right to the show, where we watch them perform the entire song. And this should come as no surprise to any of you who regularly watch this show, because this comes up all the time in bad movies. I get that you want to show the band performing, but why do we have to see the entire song? Anyways, after the show, I guess the guys change from their show clothes back into their regular clothes, but these clothes are completely different than the clothes they were wearing before the show. So what happened to these clothes? And these clothes? And furthermore, where did these clothes come from? Did they leave all of these clothes behind somewhere? It doesn't really matter, I'm just kind of curious as to what happened to those clothes. Just as I am curious as to what happened to those noodles. How many times did I say clothes in this episode? You know, post your guesses in the comments, but don't expect an answer from me because I have no idea. So the gang gets confronted by a bunch of angry people in cars. Turns out this is the old band from the club that lost their job. And I guess the rest of these people are friends of the band. Violent friends. All right, guys, grab your bats and barbed wire. We gotta go support the band. They need our help. And again, I mean no disrespect here. I understand Mark is kind of the leader of the group, but I just think it would have been a better idea to give one of the other characters this line.
Listen to me. I don't want to have any trouble. I just get the job from agent. Don't bother us.
So the bad guys call over one of their friends, like, yeah, do it, dude. And you'd expect this guy was gonna do something crazy or unique, but no. This guy just comes over and pours beer on their heads. In fact, John kind of leans into it. Of course, this starts the whole fight scene, and I'm not exactly sure what happened on the set, but I'm thinking maybe they should have rehearsed this a few more times, you know, just to make it a little bit more fluid. Because just watch this. These guys just end up standing there, frozen, waiting to get hit. Now in this scene, Jim gets a letter, and apparently he's been looking to find his father who disappeared.
This is your real father?
Yes, it is.
Are you sure?
I didn't know you had a father. I thought we are all orphans.
Wait, what was that? Orphans? You thought you were all orphans? I gotta say, Mark, that's quite the assumption to make. Unless, of course, at some point you discuss this? I don't know how that would come up. Yeah, I think we got a really cool sound going on, you know? I'm telling you guys, this band is going places. Dragon Sound is going places. So you guys orphans, or? Anyways, this scene has an incredible monologue delivered by Jim about his missing father. And the funny thing about it, though, is that he starts crying at the beginning of the monologue instead of kind of building up to it. So there's multiple points where you think he's done, but he just keeps going.
My mother was Korean. And my father was Black American. She gave me this picture when she was real sick. I was only 9 years old. They say that they loved each other and they were real loyal. They were real happy. But then when he finished military duty, he left. And we never saw him again. She told me to find him. But I didn't like him because he left us. But I knew one day when I grew up, I'd find him. Whether he was dead or alive. I sent a couple letters to the Defense Department. Nothing happened.
think that Jim's monologue from Miami Connection should be used all the time. Any situation you find yourself in, you know, job interview, first date, just bust it out. Bust out Jim's monologue, just hit him with it. And just wait for the reaction. See what reaction you get. I think that, I'm calling it now. I think that's my piece of life advice for 2018. When in doubt, bust it out. I'm referring to Jim's monologue, of course. Not your genitals. There is the very real possibility that the person you're with might want to see your genitals after hearing Jim's monologue. Because, I mean, come on, you hit him with that. Especially if you get the tears going, you know, because he left us. Like, oh man. You have to fend him off with a stick. And then it just cuts to them having a great time on the beach. And I'm not really sure what the point of this sequence is. I'm really not sure why this is in the movie. To show them having fun? Okay. But nothing happens here. The only thing that happens on the beach is apparently Tom trying to be the creepiest guy on the beach.
Excuse me, madame. May I have a little kiss, please? A little kiss, please. Come on.
Whoop!
Ooh, who the hell are you?
Jerk.
An asshole.
Get away from us.
And also, I gotta say, this guy seems to be wearing a lot of clothing for a preaching nudist. This guy's wearing a lot of clothing for just being on the beach, period. Then we have this scene of them practicing Taekwondo, which just goes on forever. I get that you want to show that they're well-trained, you know, fine. But this scene goes on for pretty much 4 whole minutes. So the old band goes to Jeff and asks him to get rid of Dragon Sound so that they can have their old job back.
Yeah. It's just one thing you gotta know. They're all black belts in Taekwondo and they're pretty bad. If you get my job back for me, any money I make is yours.
Well, that doesn't make much sense from a revenue standpoint. I mean, why don't you just find another place to play? I'm sure there's more than one venue in Orlando. And seriously, perhaps this should tell you something about the quality of music your band is producing. You guys lost your gig playing at a bar to a band who writes songs about friendship and whose guitarist isn't even really playing his instrument. So maybe instead of spending your time trying to run this band out of town, you guys should get to practicing. The fight sequences are all right. There's just a few moments where it's kind of funny. Like at this part, how does this guy miss? So they kick everyone's ass, even beat up Janice from the Muppets apparently. And here comes the Miami Connection, I guess. The ninja biker gang has arrived from Miami. Obviously more bikers than ninjas here. And this whole scene is basically just showing Yoshido and the gang. It goes on and nothing happens. It's just a bunch of shots of bikers drinking and talking. Then nothing really happens. Tom writes some music. Nothing really happens. Then finally something happens. The guys are driving out to a restaurant and Tom gets kidnapped by the gang. Now this fight scene is pretty cool, but I gotta say, this gang really sucks at being a gang. I mean, you've already fought these guys once during the day and lost. Did you really think a cover of Darkness and splitting off into groups of 2 or 3 was really gonna help you beat them this time? Anyways, during the fight, Jeff falls and dies, and this really pisses off Yoshido, who vows that Dragon Sound will not escape the Miami Ninja. Well, maybe he should be more pissed off that Jeff and him even picked a fight with this band to begin with. And what was this fight even about in the first place? Drugs? No. Money? No. Jeff was just pissed off because his sister was dating a musician, and the old band was butthurt because they lost their job. Who cares? You're selling cocaine! So one day, Jim goes out to the mailbox and gets a letter about his father. I'm assuming this is right before his shower because this seems to be his pre-shower look. I mean, come on, Jim. One thing at a time, man. Like, who gets ready for a shower? Takes off the shirt, gets the towel ready, unzips the pants, and then just, you know what? I gotta check the mail first. I would zip up, but the fly is down, and that's where it shall stay. This is who I am, world, so get ready. I'm coming out!
My father! My father! I found my father! Oh my God!
So they all pool their money together and decide to buy Jim a suit, and I mean, it's nice to see them happy for their friend, but holy crap, guys, I understand you're excited, but are you gonna parade him down the neighborhood like this? Tom, how about you finish drying off and at least put on some pants first? So they go out to reunite Jim with his father, but here come the ninjas, being really discreet on their motorcycles, as ninjas are known to do. And you know what's coming here. Somehow this gang of ninjas isn't very good at being ninjas. And of course, Jim gets injured. So they take Jim to the hospital, and suddenly his father is just there, sitting with the rest of them. And I have to say, this guy looks pretty young. I mean, the photo from before was one that Jim had from when he was a kid, and this isn't even the same actor. But it doesn't matter because it's all over, and all the bad guys are dead, apparently. Except all the bikers we saw before. I never saw them die, so.
I was gonna mess with our band again.
Now we're all safe.
Jim, it's all over.
Let's all go home.
Miami Connection is one of the reasons why I love watching bad movies. This is a great bad movie. I really recommend that you guys check this one out because it is very entertaining. Now, as for the next video, I'm not exactly sure what movie I'll be covering yet. I gotta watch Cool as Ice, maybe some Masters of the Universe. Who knows what else? I gotta check the list, but thanks for being patient on this one, guys. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all next time. That's the funny thing about this show. Everybody thinks that I'm drinking all the time. I actually rarely drink, but I do wanna drink tonight. I really do. Yeah, I think I'm going to get one. I'm on page one. I'm not even close. Okay, trying to get back on track here, Mark. Focus. Beer first. You know, you got to give that man some serious credit. The guy is just ripped, like, still. And it's just like, me, I'll do half a workout and be like, all right, that was good for the day, week, month. The only time I've seen music try and stop drugs, the only music intentionally try and stop drug use is drugs, 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 which are good, which are bad. Oh, Jesus, Mark, come on.